And he got out, and he's just an old redneck preacher. I'm talking about country redneck preacher. But I promise y'all, that man loves the Lord more than anybody I know. I talked to him yesterday. I called him and left a message on his phone. And he called me back on my cell phone later, and he said, "Brother Scott," he said, "I got your message." He said, "Praise the Lord." He said, "I've been asking the Lord, let me get another service out there," and he done laid it on your heart. And when I started listening to him and just listening to every single thing he said, everything he said was praising God. Everything he said was worshiping God. Everything he said was thanking God. And some of the boys says he don't even breathe when he preaches. He just preaches until he's done, he's done. You know, he's just wide open. But when I was talking to him, I was telling the Lord, "Thank you for letting me be around people like this." You know, because I had just had a guy in there for an hour that was, it was depressing hearing his story. I mean, this dude's been through more stuff than I could ever imagine going through. And so I was kind of down, and then I talked to Teddy, and he's just like all fired up and everything. And this morning, 5 o'clock in the morning, I don't know why I've been waking up at 5 o'clock. I don't like waking up at 5 o'clock, but if the Lord wants to wake me up at 5, he's good. But 5 o'clock this morning, I was thanking Jesus for Teddy. Because he loves Jesus, man. You know, I love to be around people that love Jesus. He didn't say a word about the church, a word about anything. He just loves Jesus. Amen, Brother Scott. Amen, Brother Scott. Hallelujah. Anyway, I just had to share that. Y'all can do what y'all want to do. I'm good.
You guys can stand and sing with us tonight. We have a good Father.
And I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. I've seen many searching for answers far and wide, but I know we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, 'cause you know just what we need before we say you. Good, good Father, it's who you are, it's who you are, it's who you are, and I'm loved by you, it's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am, you're a good, good Father, it's who you are, it's who you are. It's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. And you are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. Perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. To us. It's love so undeniable. I can hardly speak. He's so unexplainable. I can hardly think as you call me. Deeper still as you call me. Deeper still as you call me. Deeper still in the love, love, love. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are, and I am loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are, and I am loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am, it's who I am. And you are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us. You are perfect in all. Father, it's who you are, it's who you are, it's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are, it's who you are. It's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am.
Your mercy never fails me. In all my days, I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire, and in darkest nights, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father, I've known you as a friend, and I have lived in the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. will sing of the goodness of God. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now, I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now, I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Oh, I'm gonna sing of the goodness of God.
His plans are good for us.
Amazing love that wells. bought with blood, wholeheartedly, my soul undeserving. God, you're so good. God, you're so good. God, you're so good. God, you're good. God, you're so good. God, you're so good. God, you're so good. You're so good to me. God, you're so
God's good, ain't he? You feel his presence in this place? I used to would have said, if you don't feel that, your feelers broke, but I know that we feel God and hear God different ways, so I'm not going to say that, but I'm sure sad you're not a feeler right now, because I feel it. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. God, you are good. No, everything don't always go our way. Everything don't always work out the way we want it to. Truth is, in the world, we don't always win. We don't always get what we want, but with you, you're good all the time. I mean, you're good to us. We don't deserve it. None of us deserve it. That's what makes you so awesome, is how good you are to us, how much you love us. I mean, how much you want us. I mean, you want us. Thank you for that. Thank you for being so good. We worship you tonight. We honor you tonight. And you are a good Father. And you know, my little peanut mind can't understand and can't comprehend. But I can't wait to be with you. I mean, I'm not trying to check out early. I'm wanting to do what you call me to do. But I can't wait to be with you and to really understand and grasp everything. Because I don't understand and grasp everything right now. But you're so much better than I could ever imagine. You're just awesome. And we love you. We love you. And we thank you. We thank you for everything that you've done. And we honor you in this place. We lift you up in this place. And we just thank you for just being who you are in our life and helping us to be who we're supposed to be in you. And we give you praise for it, Lord, in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That was good worship, guys. Amen. And that last song, y'all go ahead and be ready to pull up the words on that last song because it's crazy. Tommy asked me a little while ago, he said, is the title of your message, God is Good? And I said, no. But that last song is exactly what we're going to talk about. In the book, Kingdom Disciples, Tony Evans is starting to talk about the title of the chapter is Ready to Upset the World. And he lists one scripture in the book of Acts. And there's so much more in the book of Acts. And he could have wrote a whole other book on what, you know, what he did than what he did. I mean, he wrote a couple pages, but he just used like two scriptures. And so I'm not going to just use two scriptures. So y'all going to have to bear with me. And I told Glenna tonight, I said, you know, this book was actually intended to be a small group. 8 weeks. There's no stinking way. I'm on page 29 in my notes, and I ain't even got there yet with you guys. There's no way, man. That's some good stuff in here. But there's some good Holy Ghost stuff in here. You know, y'all know that we all look through filters differently, right? So some people look through filters totally different than he does, and so I see things a little bit different than he does, and so I'm going to add to some of the stuff that he talked about. But the scripture that he used was Matthew 28:19, where Jesus said, go into all the world and preach the gospel, make disciples to all nations. To all nations. And he stops there with this. And then it says, ready to upset the world. And in Acts 17, this is the verse that he used. In Acts chapter 17, verse 6, I'm going to read that, and then we're going to go on a journey. How many of y'all like to go on a spiritual journey? We're going to go on a journey tonight. It's going to be good. But looky here. In Acts chapter 17, Paul and Silas, the chapter before, had been arrested and put into prison. Y'all know they sang and the walls come down, and the jailer got saved, his family got saved. Well, now they're questioning them about that. And Paul and Silas wasn't there, and so they grabbed Jason, one of his friends, it says, but they couldn't find them. They couldn't find Paul and Silas, so they dragged Jason and some of the other believers to the city officials. Didn't say they were like the, quote, disciples. It was other believers. It was people that they had won to the Lord and that they were discipling. It said they dragged Jason and some of the other believers to the city officials. These men, they were talking, these men have caused trouble all over the world. Hallelujah. The 17th chapter, the 6th verse, it says, these men have caused trouble all over the world. They didn't have cell phones. They didn't have cable. They didn't have satellite. They had word of mouth and the power of the Holy Ghost. Oh my goodness. I'm going to be as honest as I can be, and it's been stirring in my spirit, man. The song, the words to the song that we sang just a minute ago should have been written in Acts chapter 1. Because truly, we sung it with a grateful heart, and it's awesome. But they, you remember when we was talking about the difference between knowing something and application of something? Don't get mad at me. We're growing. We know that song and we love that song. I love the words of that song, but they applied that song to every single day life. It said, I'm blessed, I'm whole. Bring the song up. I ain't going no further. Bring the song. We can go back to the scripture. I'm going to do this. Will it take you long? You got it, ain't you, buddy? Look, I'm blessed, I'm called. They were. I love the book of Acts. How many of y'all have read the book of Acts? Our church is supposed to look like the book of Acts. That was the first church. It's the most powerful church. And that's what we're supposed to look like. Amen? I am blessed. I am called. I am healed. I am whole. We honestly don't have a lot of Christians walking around whole. We got a lot of Christians walking around depressed, upset, messed up, busted, disgusting, can't be trusted. I'm wanting us to get to the place, and some of you are there, I'm just saying, but I want us all to get to the place where we're all walking in this, because this is for us. He says, I'm blessed, I'm called, I'm healed, I'm whole, I am saved in Jesus' name. Now, I love this right here. Highly favored. You know that you're supposed to be highly favored? Highly favored of God. I remember Marla Nelson's sister. I don't remember her name, but you know, first time I seen her, she come walking into church, and she was in all black. She was a pastor's daughter, all black, into the gothic stuff. And man, you could feel the evil mess off of her. But when she got saved, she'd tell you, I'm God's favorite. I'm highly favored. She walked in that, man. She wanted you to know that she was highly favored. She'd been delivered a lot, and she loved a lot, and she was loved a lot. I'm highly favored, anointed. They were anointed. We're getting ready to talk about it. I didn't know Tommy was singing this song. I'm sorry, Tommy. I said yes to the plan, but I did not look at the plan. Filled with your power. Anointed. Filled with your power for the glory of Jesus' name. The difference between the first church and this church is we know about it, but we ain't applying it. Every now and again we do. So how did they get in verse chapter 17, verse 6? How did they get to a place where they caused trouble in all the world? How did they get to that place? Jesus had died, right? He come back and he told them, he said, look, guys, he said, I'm going to send you out in Matthew 28, the Great Commission. I'm going to send you out. I want you to go out and I want you to tell people about me. I want you to teach them. I want you to baptize them. I want you to go to all nations. And they're looking at a government that was a religious bunch of mess. They're looking at a bunch of religious people who had just killed Jesus, and Jesus is telling them, I'm sending you. So then on this journey, they start. They go to Acts chapter 1, verse 8. And Jesus told them, right before he told them to go and be endued with power from on, he said, I'm going to give you power, dunamis, to be my witnesses. So the very first thing was they got filled with the Holy Ghost. Most churches don't even know what being filled with the Holy Ghost is, and I'm not being critical, and that's what I told the Lord today. I've made the Lord a promise, and I'm trying to keep it. I said, Lord, I ain't talking about no other churches. I ain't talking about no other preachers. I'm going to do the best I can to keep my mouth shut, and you deal with them. I'm not the one supposed to deal with them, so I'm going to try. But when I see stuff, it gets me fired up, and I'm like, come on, people! Amen? Y'all ever feel that way sometimes? You see stuff and you're like, have you fell and bumped your religious head? But these people were facing this stuff. They was facing religious people. And they'd been walking, even the religious people had done what Jesus said and did all the sacrifices and stuff and kept that. But now when Jesus come, he said, hey, all this is changing. So he said, I'm going to endue you with power from on high, and you're going to be witnesses in Judea, Samaria, and you'll be my witnesses from one end of the earth to the other. Acts 17, 6 said it caused trouble in all the world. We know they wasn't causing trouble. It's trying to bring life. So you speed up. How did they do it? That's the question I asked. I wrote in big red letters, how did they do it? I want to tell you how they got from Matthew 28:18 to all the way to Acts 17:6, where it's causing trouble in all the world. It was the Holy Ghost. It wasn't nothing but the Holy Ghost. It wasn't church. It wasn't preachers. It was the Holy Ghost. We need the Holy Ghost. People are scared of the Holy Ghost. People don't talk about the Holy Ghost. I'm telling you right now, we need the Holy Spirit to move in our life. If we don't, we're just going to be normal old people, come in the same old way, sit down, go out the same way, never lay hands on the sick, never cast out devils, never raise the dead, never do anything that he said we can do, never be anointed, never be whole, never be blessed, never be none of that stuff. Without the Holy Ghost, we ain't going to have it. Y'all need to wake up in this place. Acts chapter 2, he tells them 40 days later, he says, I want you to go and I want you to assemble up and I want you guys to get together. And 120 people got in the upper room. And it says that they were praying, they were seeking God, and they was in one accord. And it wasn't a Honda. Another thing that stops the move of God is we're not in one accord. I had an awesome talk with a Baptist brother today. We do not agree on our theology, and we know we don't agree on our theology, and we embrace that we didn't agree on our theology. I know this man loves God. I know this man serves God. I know this man walks for God. I know this man don't sin and do all kind of stupid stuff. He lives it. Just because he don't believe what I believe, he walks it as good as I do. And we need to learn that we got to disagree. Just because somebody don't believe with us and believe the same way we believe, we got to get over that junk. That's another thing that's stopping the move of God. 120 people in the upper room. And it says that suddenly the Holy Ghost came and he fell and he landed on all of them. Like fire landed on all of them. And they were filled and they began to speak in tongues. There was 14 different nationalities there and they spoke in the tongues that they could understand. They needed that. They needed the power. How was they going to fulfill what Jesus told them to do? They couldn't do it in themselves. Crap, they couldn't even stand up for Jesus. I said that word. I'm sorry, y'all. I'm fired up. Y'all going to have to excuse me. I'm excited. How was they going to do it? They're facing all this persecution, all this junk. Acts chapter 1, he said, I'm going to endure your power. Acts chapter 2, they get filled with the Holy Ghost. Peter stands up and says, these men are not drunk as you suppose. It's only 12 o'clock. If it's 9 o'clock at night, maybe you could say that. But no, it's 12 o'clock. He said, but these guys are filled with the Holy Ghost, just like Jules said in 2:28. In the last days, I'll pour out my spirit upon all flesh. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your young men shall dream dreams. Your old men shall have visions. And I will pour out my spirit upon all of my handmaids. Woo! Everybody. We ain't got the spirit poured out. Heck. We don't even let the spirit move. If we move, do whatever you want. That's why I look back at Thomas and said, do whatever you want. I just want the spirit to move. I don't care if I never preach another message. If I come in here every Sunday and every Wednesday night and the spirit of God fell and you got jacked up and we got messed up and we worship God and he was happy, I'm happy. Amen. Don't matter. Amen. Acts chapter 3. Oh boy. God's moving like crazy. Trouble starts. They start doing things for God. Acts chapter 3, 4, and 5, you can look at it and read it. You know, they'd be walking around, and the lame man was sitting there, and they pray for the lame man, and God heals him. Gets up and runs around, and he goes and tells everybody, and they come back thinking Peter and John had done something. And Peter said, don't look on us like we've done something. We ain't done nothing. It's this Jesus that you crucified. So, man, they get ticked off. The Sanhedrin says, hey, we got to stop this. Bring these boys in. Let's talk to them. So they bring them in. They start talking to them. I'm taking you on a history lesson now. You ready? History. Bible class 101. I'm breathing hard. I'm excited. They bring them in. I said, look, boys, I don't know what you think you're doing, but you're going to have to stop this stuff. Peter said, don't look at it. We didn't do it. We did this. The guy that you killed, who God raised again, is the one that brought this man's lame self back up. We didn't have anything to do with it. And they said, listen, boys, you better go out and you better keep your mouth shut. Don't do this anymore. So they let them go. Well, what do? They go out and they start preaching the gospel. Something else happened. A great miracle happens. They come in. They go get them again. They bring them before the Sanhedrin. They said, did we not tell you to keep your mouth shut? Didn't we tell you boys to shut up? And Peter looked at him and said, who are we supposed to listen to, you or God? That's another thing that's missing in the church. We're trying to speak what men want to hear, not what God says to speak. We need to speak the word, not some watered down mess. Peter said, who are you, man, to tell me that I can't talk about my God? I'm going to do that. So they got so mad they wanted to kill him. But a smart man stood up and he said, hang on, fellas, let's get them out of here. They took them out of the room. They said, listen, guys, they had a board meeting. Trusty board meeting. They said, listen, fellas, just let them keep going. We've seen this happen before. You remember this sect raised up and this sect raised up and this sect raised up, but they all died out. Listen, just let them keep going. You're making too big of a deal out of this. Just let them go on, and it'll fizzle out if it's not of God. Say, bring them in. They said, listen, boys, we're not telling you again. You better get your junk together and you better keep your mouth shut. You're trying to blame us for killing this man. And Peter said, you did kill him. So they whooped him. I mean, whooped him good. And sent him out. And the disciples go out. Now, I'm talking about disciples now. Not converts, disciples. We got a bunch of converts. We ain't got a bunch of disciples. And these disciples go out. And they were so excited because they got to suffer persecution for Jesus. No, y'all ain't getting this. We can't even get people to come to church. And they ready to line up again to get their butts whooped for Jesus just so they can speak his name in front of the Sanhedrin and whoever else will listen. That's a disciple of Jesus Christ. Amen. Big deal if you put Jesus loves you on Facebook and then you smoke, drink, and cuss and do everything else that you know you ain't supposed to do. If you ain't supposed to do it, let's put it that way. The shoe fits, wear it. Why y'all look at me like that? Well, you just do it good till you said that. Now you're going to meddling. No, I'm preaching. Amen. Hallelujah. It didn't stop there, man. That's when the persecution started. They got so mad, they told them and said, okay, we're going to fix you. We're going to kill you. Saul started bringing havoc on the church. If you look up that word, it means to come in like a tornado, a hurricane, to blow the place up. He started taking men and women and taking them off to jail. He started having them killed. They started burying them alive, burning them alive, pulling their bodies apart and doing all this stuff. And they still preaching Jesus. In the church today, just a little bit of persecution, we flip out. Are y'all listening to what I'm saying? I'm showing you the difference between what we're supposed to be and what we are. Come on. I'm talking about me too. I'm stirred up with this thing. I'm wanting to see revival. We can't see revival until the Holy Ghost falls. Amen. They would have never seen revival. 5,000 people saved one day, 2,000 people saved the next. They would have never seen it if the Holy Ghost wouldn't have failed. Good singing and good preaching ain't gonna cut it. We need the Holy Ghost to fall. We do. So keep on going. I'm getting excited. Saul comes on the scene. Stephen was just a servant. And Stephen starts preaching. And they hear about Stephen preaching. They come and grab Stephen. They said, boy, we told y'all to keep your mouth shut. And Stephen said, you uncircumcised, stiff neck. Hallelujah, I love Stephen. We'd had a son that's going to be named Stephen, wasn't it? You know what our daughter was going to be named? Shekinah. That didn't go over good. Allison was going to be called Shekinah Glory if it had been up to me, but Glenna won out. Stephen said, you uncircumcised, stiff neck. You know what that means? You're like an ox that won't turn. Stiff neck. He said, he didn't stop there. He said, you're just like your fathers. Your fathers killed the prophets, now you killed Jesus. You're just like them. You're no better than they are. Boy, they got mad. They jumped on him and gnashed on him with their teeth. And they killed him. They killed him right there. And Saul was standing there. They laid their coats at Saul's feet. And it says he was consenting to their death. Saul was a very religious man. Matter of fact, if you go back and study, he studied under Gamaliel, who was the greatest Jewish teacher that ever lived. Paul followed the letter of the law. So Paul gets upset and he says, okay, chapter 7 comes along. He says, okay, we're going to fix this thing. We're going to shut them up once and for all. He goes and he gets papers to go and have them killed, to have them drug out, put in prison and killed. And he's going to on the road to Damascus to get it done. He's got the paperwork in his hands. but Jesus. See, Jesus took a man named Saul who was willing to die for what he believed, even though what he believed was wrong, and turned his heart around and changed him to where that's why you got chapter 17, verse 6, is because Saul got saved on the road to Damascus and God changed his name to Paul and he got filled with the Holy Ghost and the rest is history. That's why the church went from here to here. That's how they did it. The Holy Ghost. What did Paul preach everywhere he went? Have you received the Holy Ghost since you've been saved? That's what he had asked them. He found, and see, some people don't believe that the Holy being baptized in the Holy Ghost is a separate work. It's a totally separate work than when you get saved. When you get saved, you get salvation, but you get the Holy Spirit. But to be baptized in the Holy Spirit is to be baptized with the gifts and be baptized with the power of the Holy Ghost. There's a lot of saved people that have the Spirit that ain't got the power of the Spirit. And Paul saw two of John's disciples one time. He said, hey, guys, have you received the Holy Ghost since you've been saved? And you know what they said? They said, we ain't even heard of such a Holy Ghost. You know what most of the church has? They ain't even heard of the Holy Ghost. If we was to be honest, some of you don't understand the Holy Ghost. And you need to study in God's Word and get in God's Word and see what He's doing. And I'm about to snot all over myself. I'm excited. Because this is what we need. This is what we need. And God radically changed him. And then he started picking up people, ministering to people, and he would see them and say, have you received the Holy Ghost? You remember how when Philip goes down to baptize, he baptizes the eunuch, and then he leaves and he goes, and a revival breaks out in Samaria. The outcasts, the worst of the worst, the Keon, whatever his name is, Kanye. Tanya, whoever. What's his name? Kanye. Yeah, that guy. Man, I don't even know him. I didn't even know who Lady Gaga was and somebody else they was watching. I don't even know who they are. I don't even know them people. I don't watch that trash. But I'm glad he got saved. Amen. So Jesus sends him and he goes down and Philip starts preaching to the Samaritans. And man, they're all messed up. They got crazy books and witchcraft and all this stuff going on. And they get saved. And the disciples hear about it, and they send Peter and John to fat cats down there to see what's going on in Samaria. Where did Jesus say that you was going to go to? Jerusalem, Judea, and Samaria. They already working it out, baby. They down in Samaria, and Philip, who was just an usher, he was just a waiter, is down there preaching Jesus. It's another thing we don't hear a lot of. We don't hear a lot of preaching Jesus. Preaching the Bible, but don't preach Jesus. Amen? And he starts preaching, and the disciples hear about it. So Peter and John come down, and they start talking to him, and the Bible plainly says that many believed. And then when Peter and John come down, they look at him, and they said, look, have you received the Holy Ghost yet? Because the Bible says it had not fallen on them yet. Now, wait a minute. If they're saved, I thought you got everything when you got saved. No, you don't. It's nine gifts of the Spirit. And the Bible said that the Spirit gives the gifts the way He wants to. So when you got saved, that's just the beginning. Did y'all hear what I just said? When you got saved, that's just the beginning. You'll be saying, praise God, I ain't the way I was when I got saved, or I'd still be that way. There's a lot of people that didn't get saved that think they got saved and are still living the same way. Listen, I want you to hear me good. There's no way you can get saved and filled with the Spirit of God and live the same way you was living. There is no way. You can't tell me that. There ain't no way you'll ever convince me of that. Your life ain't never going to change until you're filled with the Spirit of God. Amen. Ever. Amen. Good people can quit drinking. Good people can quit cussing. Good people can start coming to church. Good people aren't anointed. Good people aren't praying for the sick and seeing them healed. Only people filled with the Spirit of God. And we need the Spirit of God. Amen? I want every single one of you in this room to be filled with the Spirit of God. I want you to start praying about that. Y'all hear me? I want you to start praying about it on Sundays. I want people to be filled with the Spirit of God. I can't fill you. I can't teach you how to do all that stuff. There's places that's not wrong. That's not right. That's not biblical. You can't teach somebody how to speak in tongues. You can't teach somebody how to prophesy. You can't teach that. That's a gift from God, the gift from the Holy Spirit. But you can ask for it. Ask him. Seek to prophesy. That's what the Word says. So many churches put the emphasis on speaking in tongues. That's the least of the gift. That's the least of the gift. Seek to prophesy. Seek to edify the church. I would to God that I'd come in here and a real man or woman of God would really prophesy to the church. Amen. I hope this has fired you up a little bit. This ain't no condemning whatsoever. This is, hey, this is the direction we need to go. We need the Spirit of God. How did they make a difference? How did they make disciples? They got filled with the Holy Ghost. How did they stand up against persecution? How did they stand up against religious organizations? How did they stand up against the government? Because they was filled with the Holy Ghost and power. I don't know about y'all, but I want it. I want more. I honestly believe I've walked in more than I'm walking in now. Does that make sense? Anybody else feel like that? I've walked in more than I'm walking in now. So guess what? He didn't decrease. His power didn't decrease. My availability and my prayer life and my doing what I'm supposed to do, I got to step up my game. Amen? I got to step up my game. I got to get closer to God. I got to want more of him. I got to desire more of him. I miss opportunities. You ever miss opportunities? I don't want to miss opportunities. I've been thinking about this stuff for 2 days now. God, and I've been praying this morning. I was praying all morning. God, get me back to where I used to look for opportunities. Man, you barely opened the door. I'd have kicked it in. And now it's like I'm trying to pick and choose. Which ones, you know, is this even worth dealing with right here? Is this worth doing? It's all worth it. May not work out, but it's all worth it. Yeah, it's messy. But God wants to use us. Look for opportunities. And when God gives you the opportunity, take it. You're blessed. You're called. You're filled. You're whole. You're anointed. Chosen. Filled with the Holy Ghost. Let's quit singing about it and start applying it. If there's anybody in this room that's upset right now, shame on you. You shouldn't be. You should be excited. And you should be praying more for me. You should be saying, sick him, Lord. Sick him, Lord. Sick him, Lord. That's what you should be praying for me. I should feel like, man, what in the world's going on here? These people, y'all should be praying for me like that. Because you know what? It starts here. It starts here. I'm ready to see it explode. I was walking out here today. I've never walked on the property and thought, man, this could be a church right here. I ain't talking about this. I'm talking about right up around that big hill, all that property we got. I'm not a visionary. Y'all have been in my class. I'm not a visionary. And I'm sitting up there, and all of a sudden it hits me, this could be a church. And I chuckled. I ain't gonna lie to you. I chuckled. I said, yeah, right. We can't fill the one we got. And I said this, Lord, you got to send a whole lot more money than we're taking in to build a church. And it's like everything just got dead quiet. I said, Lord, I'm sorry. I said, I tell you what, if you want to build a church, I'll build a church. Amen. Whatever you want to do, I'll do. I ain't a visionary, never claimed to be a visionary. But if you want to do it, you know how to do it, you bring the people in to do it, and we'll do it. Amen. I'll foster anything you want to do. Amen. But we need the Holy Ghost. Amen. 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 Y'all going to pray for it? Amen. Listen. There's one little scripture that I didn't talk about. But after they went in and had gotten beaten and they were so happy, it says that the place was filled again and the place shook and they were filled with the Holy Ghost. They done got filled with the Holy Ghost. There's more feelings. So if you've gotten filled with the Holy Spirit, there's more feelings. It's not just a one-time hurrah. You keep getting filled and keep getting filled. The Bible says that Jesus was filled without measure. I want more. I'm so jacked up when I come here tonight. I won't be jacked up all the time. He said they got favor with everybody. You know, when you go up there this week, I pray you get favor. Everywhere you go, I pray for favor. For favor. For favor in your business. You do what's right and God will give you favor. Favor on your business. Favor whatever you're doing. Favor on all of you. And anointing. To share, man. Somebody say something. If somebody says something about being sick or something, say, can I pray for you? Don't be scared. Just pray for them. They got something going. You need to talk about it. Talk to them. Yeah, it's going to get dirty and messy. Who cares? Help them. Amen. At least reach out. If they don't reach back out, there ain't nothing you can do. At least you try. Amen. I could preach till 10 o'clock, but I'm going to let y'all go. Stand with me. Hey, go read. Go read the book of Acts this week. Okay? That's your homework. I don't ever give you homework. Start Matthew 28, the very end, and watch their journey and go through it. And watch how, and do this. Look at their church and what was going on there, and look at the United States and what's going on here, and you tell me what's missing. It's the power of the Holy Ghost. It's the power of the Holy Ghost. We got to have it. I've been telling the Lord, I got to have it, I got to have it, I got to have it. You know, I used to preach on it, and I would hear people preach on it, and man, I've wanted to lay hands on people like Paul did and see them receive the Holy Ghost and stuff. Chris Smith did that a lot. That's just never been one of my giftings. And I've been praying, God, I want to lay hands on people and they get the Holy Ghost. Amen. I've been in a jail cell with Chris Smith with a bunch of, I'm not trying to be mean, but stinking. It stunk in there, just stinking mess. And inmates don't know nothing about the Bible hardly. He preached on the Holy Ghost, lay hands on them, and they shabba-ba and everything. It's just Holy Ghost falling everywhere. And I'm like, woo! Amen. Raise us up, Lord. Raise us up. We don't care what it looks like, what it smells like. We don't care. We want you in your fullness. Because we ain't even tapped into the, we ain't even reached the tip of the eye. We hadn't done nothing, Lord. There's so much more that we can experience in you. And I pray you pour your spirit out on this church. In power, Lord. Not in emotion, but in power. And in demonstration. And in application through our life. The way we pray for people. And encourage people and give people a word. You give us a word for people, Lord, that we can speak into them life and not death. Help us to love like you love. I prayed yesterday. You know my heart. I prayed you'd help me feel what people are feeling. Help me be the pastor that feels what people are feeling so I don't just flippantly talk to people and not take it as serious as I should. If I felt it, I would take it more serious and I'd be more invested in it than just kind of going through the pastor motion. I don't want to do that mess. Lord, we love you and we want to please you. We want you to be happy with us. Not because we're trying to earn your applause, because you already love us. But because we just love you and we want to please you. Move by your Spirit. Breathe Holy Spirit in this place. Move in this place in power and in might. In Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Amen. Love you guys. God bless you.